this knowledge out there and being presented, and whatever we can do to push it and foster it, we're going to be working toward it. Thank you.
Is going to be bringing lunch, and that is just a bologna sandwich, okay? It's going to be a nice lunch, and we also have fruit trays and cookies for afternoon. So I just want you all to know that we appreciate your coming. We thank you folks very much, and we're just happy to have you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll do it.
All right. By the way, has anybody discovered our little secret in our book?
Yes.
So let me ask this question before you say it. Where do students always look when they get a new textbook?
For the answers.
Yes.
For the back.
For what?
The answer.
The answer. Oh, see, our A students up here on this row didn't know that yet. All the answers are in the back. Now, I didn't tell you that at the beginning, on purpose. Because I really don't want you going like this and just, you know, I just kind of want you to listen. If you'll notice, I'm not reading this material. And it would be nice if you don't read it. Just listen, participate in the discussion, and I'll give you the blanks. But there are some people once in a while that just can't stand to have to leave a blank. And we're going to leave a few blanks because we're already a little behind. We tell too many stories, but that's okay. So I just want you to know, if we leave a blank, don't worry. When you go home and do your homework, you can fill them all in. Okay? All right. Now I've said that, we're going to go to the bottom of page 15. And I want to talk to you a little bit about political spectrums. Today, it's very popular in the media, for example, to hear about the what and the what?
Left and the right.
The left and the right, correct? That's your left over there. Left and the right. What do you normally hear and think about being way over on the far left, as far as you can go?
Anarchy.
Yeah, some kind of...
liberal.
Barbra Streisand.
Some kind of very tyrannical, worst form of tyranny. What's the worst we know of today? Communism. International revolutionary communism. Communism on the left. And then you've heard... usually in the press they'll say this, that guy is so far right, he's a fascist. You heard of that?
Yep.
So you get this kind of feeling, fascism on the right, communism on the left. Well, a spectrum is supposed to include everything. If that is the spectrum, if that were the spectrum that includes everything, I ask you, where are you? Are you in the middle? Are you a moderate? Call me a moderate. What's a moderate?
Conservative.
Kind of wondering which way the political winds are blowing. There was a fellow running for a statewide office in my state years ago. He used to go around the state saying, I'm a little right of center. Okay, kind of interesting. I was tempted to go up to him and say, Fred, you keep saying you're a little right of center. Does that mean you're a little closer to fascism and communism? That wouldn't be nice if you do that. See, that's very confusing, isn't it? When you build your spectrum on parties, it's confusing. The founders had a much better way to measure government other than this communism-fascism business. They said if you measure government, you measure it like you measure anything. Let's say you had a yardstick, and on one end would be zero. Zero government. What is that?
Anarchy.
Anarchy. No law. Chaos. Zero. And on the other end would be 100% government. What would that be?
Prison.
Tyranny. Right? Dictatorship. Tyranny. So you've got zero, which is anarchy, to 100% tyranny. And you can place then any government that's ever existed on this earth somewhere on that spectrum, depending on the amount of control that the government exercises over the people, right? You see that? That is the founders' formula. Do you want to hear the founders say that? Turn over to page 16. Look at number 3. This is Washington. He talks about from the extreme of anarchy to the extreme of tyranny. Those are two blanks. Anarchy and tyranny. Do you see those words he's using? In other words, 0 to 100%. And the founders knew, as they studied history, that nations kind of go like this. From one to they get tired of a ruler, they throw them off, and ends clear over here, and they're in anarchy. Then they have another one that brings it back. This pendulum swinging. This is the history of governments in this world. And Jefferson said, what we need to do is stop that pendulum from swinging. Look at his quote in number 4. We are now vibrating between too much and too little government, and the pendulum will rest finally in the middle of their spectrum. Now, we've given that word middle a little more descriptive term. We like to call it the balanced center. The pendulum will finally rest in the balanced center. Balance between what? Between too little government and too much government. Find the balance there. And my friends, that's what the founders struggled to find. They missed it the first time, which we'll discuss. But when they wrote the Constitution, they believed they had found the balanced center. And in my studies of that document, that truly is the balanced center, which provides just enough government, but not too much. Would you remember that? The balanced center is wonderful. Now today, Saturday, probably a great game on today, isn't there? It usually is on Saturdays. Anyway, somebody tomorrow, maybe Sunday or maybe next week at work or somewhere, somebody just might say to you, did you see that great game on Saturday? And you'll have to say, no. No, oh, you didn't. You really missed a good one. Where were you? Well, I was over at Cornerstone School. You were in school on Saturday? What in the world were you studying? And you'll say, we were studying the Constitution. The Constitution? What are you? One of those right-wing wackos? They just might say that to you. Maybe they already have. I want you to stand and say, no, I'm not right-wing, left-wing, or any other kind of wing. I'm right in the balanced center, right where the founding fathers were. Now, they'll have no idea what you're talking about. But there's a teaching moment for you. See that? And I want particularly you young people to know, if you agree with the founders, because they'll try to get you to think that you're off on some right wing. You've heard that. Mm-hmm. You are in the balanced center. You believe in just enough government to protect the rights of the people, but not too much to oppress the people. That's the balanced center of the proper spectrum. That's what's so thrilling about this message. It's balanced. We all want to be balanced. But they're trying to make us out like we're off on some tangent. So with the correct understanding now of the spectrum on page 16, let's talk just for a minute about ruler's law. Because we have to know some elements of ruler's law so when it happens, even in our country, we can identify it. Okay? So you see down at the bottom, you've got our spectrum, 0 to 100%. What's the matter with the pyramid under ruler's law? It's upside down because all the power is in the ruler. That's number 2 down at the bottom. It's in the ruler. Where are you, by the way? What's on your head? The point of the pyramid, does it hurt? We could even give a date coming up very shortly of when it really hurts, right? Okay, all right. Number three, the people are treated as subjects of the ruler. These are all my subjects, you know, all my subjects. You can hear a ruler saying that. And the land, this is all my realm, you know, all my realm. Hear a ruler saying that. Well, I tell you, this was brought home years ago in my state when President Clinton came to Arizona, stood on the rim of the Grand Canyon, and signed an executive order bottling up nearly 2 million acres in southern Utah. I don't know if you remember that or not, and declaring it as a national monument. You know what that did? That just bottles it up. No enjoyment, no exploration, just, it was almost like, this is all my realm, you know, all my realm. This is ruler's law. And didn't even have the courage to go into Utah and do it, but whatever. This is ruler's law, folks. And when we get young people to understand when these things happen and identify them, boy, that's powerful. Look at number six. Government is by the whims of men rather than the fixed rule of law. Have we not experienced this so much lately? Just these edicts that seem to be coming down by the truckload. This is ruler's law. Number 10, problems are typically solved by issuing new edicts, creating more bureaus, exactly, appointing more administrators, and charging the people more taxes to pay for these services. Freedom is never considered a viable solution to anything. Got a problem out there in Forsyth County? Let the people solve it themselves. They're smart enough. Let them solve it themselves. You won't hear a ruler saying that. We'll send out some administrators. Mm-hmm. You've felt that, haven't you? Well, number 12, the transfer of power. This is in 100% ruler's law, of course. From one ruler to another is often by violence. And when you study the history of ruler's law throughout the world, what you're really studying is the continuous existence of misery. Because the people never rise above a basic hand-to-mouth subsistence level. You would think after all these years we would kind of get a clue about that. And yet, we don't seem to be. So, and let her see, as we've said, the founder said, there's a better way. Let's pull this pyramid over to where the power is based in the people themselves. Your blank is people. Turn it right side up. And letter D, it was Thomas Jefferson who was at the forefront of the philosophy behind all this, that kind of helped put all this thinking together. So on page 18, let's talk just briefly what the founders learned as they read the Old Testament about ancient Israel, which was an example to them. First of all, can you remind me about how old Moses was when he brought the children of Israel out of Egypt?
80.
About 80, that's right. There were three 40-year periods in his life, you may remember. The first 40 years was spent where? In Egypt, in Pharaoh's court, right? What kind of law do you think Moses learned there?
Ruler's law.
Okay. Then the next 40 years was spent in the wilderness of Midian and away from all that stuff. And probably enjoyed life, herding sheep, got married. And then near the end of that 40-year period, about 80 years old, he received his call. You remember that story? And so then he went to Egypt, and you remember that story, brought the children of Israel out of Egypt, and gets them all out in the desert, and we think there's at least two million. Can you imagine, 2 million? We know there's 600,000 families from the book of Numbers, so, you know, it must be at least 2 million people. And he says to them, this is all in the 18th chapter of Exodus. He says to them, do you have any problems? Come and see me. 2 million people. Yeah, right. What did the government look like under Moses?
He was exhausted.
What was he in charge of? Well, that's true. What was he in charge of? Look at the graph on the top of the page there. He was in charge of
everything.
And that's all he knew, right? So it says, the 18th chapter says, the people lined up from morn till evening. And you kind of have to feel sorry for Moses. Probably didn't get any lunch. Probably didn't get any dinner. Probably didn't get much sleep. And when you woke up the next morning, probably the line was longer than it was the day before. And this went on for a while until a wiser, older man, you know this story, was on the sideline watching this. Who was this? Jethro, his father-in-law, who said, Moses, that which thou doest is not good. If you keep this up, you're going to waste away this people and yourself with them if you don't watch, if you don't change something. And the record doesn't say this, but you can almost hear Moses saying, well, Dad, do you have any suggestions? And Jethro would have said, yes, my son, I do. And so, of course, with the help of God, Jethro helped Moses reorganize the whole camp of Israel into what you see down at the bottom. There were 600,000 families, so the suggestion was, okay, you group all those families in groups of 10, and each of those 10 family groups will choose a leader. All right? How many leaders will you have if that happens? How many 10 family groups can you get out of 600,000 families? 60,000. You got 60,000 leaders, just like that. Then you take 5 of those 10 family groups, making 50 family groups. Each of them elect a leader. How many more leaders do you have? 12,000. You're up to 72,000 leaders. Then you take 2 of those 50 family groups, making 100 family groups. Each of them elect a leader. You're up to 78,000. You see how this is happening? Then you take 10 of those 100 family groups, making 1,000 family groups, and each of them elect a leader. You've got 78,600, don't forget Moses, and 1 leaders. And then the command was given. Now, and Moses said this, you solve your problem at the local most level, and only the hard cases you bring to me. And you can almost hear Moses go, oh, let's go have lunch or something. This is an incredible story. And there were people in the colonial period who quoted this incident and compared the 12 tribes of Israel with the 13 colonies. Those speeches are out there to read.
That's the Jeffersonian democracy.
Yeah. And this was a great example. Solve the problem at the local most level. That's why these principles on your card, Principle 21, for example, on your card. Strong local self-government is the keystone to preserving human freedom. You let the people solve the problems locally. Oh, that'd be wonderful. And keep their money. On page 19, let's talk a little bit about some of the elements of people's law in ancient Israel. First of all, they were set up as a commonwealth of freemen. What does that mean? Commonwealth of freemen. That means everyone is equal to everyone else. That's what a commonwealth of freemen means. Everybody has the same rights. They're all equal. And after it was set up and going for a while, Moses received a command from God. Proclaim liberty throughout all the land unto all the inhabitants thereof. The founders loved that scripture so much. Where did they put it in Americana? Somebody know where this is? Where?
Liberty Bell.
Right around the top of the Liberty Bell. When we take our students to Philadelphia every 2 years, and we go to the place where the Liberty Bell is there in front of Independence Hall, I say to them, now you go in there and you be sure and see that scripture on federal property. You don't even have to do that. You can go to your state capitol because every state has a replica of the Liberty Bell. And you can see that scripture on state property. Proclaim liberty. Every time that bell bonged, it was symbolically saying, you are free, I have made you free, saith the Lord. Number two, the duties and responsibilities of the people were based on religious principles and a solid commitment to morality. Morality. What was the basic moral code of ancient Israel?
Ten Commandments.
Letter A, Franklin said, and here's a couple of quotes if you're into memorizing, I highly recommend this. Only a virtuous people are capable of freedom. How do you like that? As nations become corrupt and vicious, they have more need of masters. Let me ask you this. Do you feel the masters coming?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. What must you say then, sadly, with Franklin about our people generally? We are becoming more corrupt and vicious. I mean, a free people doesn't ask for masters, right? Look at letter B. John Adams said, our Constitution was made only for a moral and religious people. It is wholly inadequate to the government of any other. So, you know, when you know these things, and then you hear people in the public arena proposing solutions to problems as they think, with no talk of morality, virtue, and so forth, you have to say, it won't work. It won't work. And it hasn't worked if you don't have this basis of morality and virtue. Number three, they were organized in small, manageable units where everyone had a voice and a vote. You see, the concept is if everyone is equal, How do you hear from everybody who's equal? You have to break it down into small, manageable units, and that's where groups of hundreds, fifties, tens. So when you go vote, where do you vote? Where do you vote? In your precinct. And it's probably within walking distance or short drive to a local school or church or wherever. So that's how you sense everybody's feeling in a commonwealth of freemen, right? Okay. Number five, they had a system of honest money. Let's see if I've got some honest money in here. Well, I've got this. Is this honest money?
No.
Why isn't this honest?
Because it's owned by the private Federal Reserve and not the American people.
Yeah. It's not worth anything. The only value this has is what you and I think it has.
Right.
And that's why we use it, unless we're made to, but whatever.
Plus, it has the coercion clause.
Yeah,
clause.
That's what we're made to. But see, this has no intrinsic value, the founder says, and it was a law in ancient Israel for your money to have intrinsic value, meaning value in and of itself. That's why precious metals has always been usually the medium, because it has value in and of itself. Why do politicians want to take value off of paper?
They can control the paper, they can control the people.
Because if this were redeemable, and you had a president like FDR who had a number of New Deal programs which required new money, if you're going to have a program to require new money, say $100 million, if you're going to generate that kind of new money, and it's redeemable, you've got to have $100 million in Fort Knox of gold and silver to back it up. That's not easy to do. See, those are limitations on politicians.
Amen.
Yeah. You take that redeemability off, what can they do? What are they doing?
Bring it all.
Just print it up. Hand it out. Say, remember me in the next election, which they did. Right? Ancient Israel had a system of honest money. a requirement for freedom.
So if you had a silver certificate in your hand, could you still redeem it?
Not since 1967 or 8.
Okay, I didn't know.
Yeah, they took the redeemability off by executive order. I'll show you that set. Anyway, number 9, all leaders, and number 10, all laws, came into force only with the approval of the people. This is most interesting. Not even God would thrust upon his people a leader or laws that they did not consent to. Isn't that interesting? Because he lets us have our agency and suffer the consequences of our agency. So you remember after the line of judges, what did the Israelites begin to demand? Gotta have a king. And poor Samuel, you know, he went to them, he said, you don't want it. You've already got a king. Jehovah is our king. Yeah, but we want a king that we can, see. And he felt so dejected. Remember the story? He went to God and he felt so dejected. And God says to Samuel, they haven't rejected you. They've rejected me. You go back and tell those people what an earthly king would do. This is a great speech in the book of Kings. What an earthly king will do. He'll take all your money.
Yes.
He'll take all your young men for his army.
Yes.
He'll build himself palaces.
Yes.
You don't want a king. Oh, but we got to be like our neighbors. Okay. So, and God does this, that he lets us suffer the consequences of our own decision. And so Samuel found a king. Nice, strong, young man, tall. Who was that?
Saul.
Oh, Samuel knows how to choose good kings.
God, I don't know.
What happened? Power went to his head. It's just like Samuel said. Anyway, what great lessons there are in the Old Testament when it comes to freedom. And the founders studied and read it. There's two volumes of Ellis Sandoz that I love to read called Political Sermons of the Founding Era. Oh my gosh. And then that's how speeches were given. Did you know that before elections in early America, most states would always have what they called election sermons? This is when the ministers of the gospel who knew the Bible would give speeches, mostly in churches, because that's the only place speeches could be given, really. There was no big amphitheaters and so forth. And they would give them to the legislators, to governors, to people who would vote, describing the kind of people you should vote for. And there's great speeches on the lessons of the Bible. Anyway.
What's the book called?
Political Sermons of the Founding Era by Ellis Sandoz. He's a professor at LSU. I think he's still there. I know he's still alive. I just got an email from him the other day. Anyway, number 11. Accused persons, this is under people's law now, accused persons were presumed to be innocent until proven guilty. If a king wants somebody arrested, he'll say, arrest that man, throw him into prison. Yeah, but your majesty, he wants a trial. Give him a trial. Well, we don't have enough evidence to convict him, your majesty. You know what the king used to do, king of England?
Find him.
He would go to parliament and say, I want a bill of attainder on that man. What's that? That's a legislative act saying the guy's guilty. And the founder said, we'll have none of that. If you can't prove a person is guilty in a court of law under rules of evidence, even if you think he's guilty, what do you have to do?
Let him go.
Knowing what?
Judgment of God.
In the final analysis, it'll catch up with it. When the final DVD is played, or however it's being recorded. You do believe, as the good book says, all the secret acts of men are being recorded. That means yours and mine, right? And will be played from the housetops, right? You know what it says? Does that bother us? Makes us want to do what? Real quick. What's that called when we change?
Repent.
Ooh, that's beautiful. And Isaiah says, those sins will become as what?
White as snow.
White as snow. In other words, blotted out. That's beautiful. Because of Christ, of course. That's a great concept. But anyway, you just have to be that philosophical and leave it to the judgment of God. So, number 12, the entire code of justice was based primarily on reparation to the victim rather than fines and punishment by the commonwealth.
Question?
If a person's, yes.
Does that mean there were no victimless crimes? Did there have to be a specific injury to a specific person for it to be a crime?
I think that's what that means. Yeah. Pardon me?
What about conscience? You don't have any, you know, if you do something wrong, your conscience will be attached.
Well, that should certainly prevent you from doing it.
Yes.
Wrong. Yeah. So if a person is convicted of a crime, what can be his punishment? What are the three main things that can be done as judgments against him? He can be
fined, imprisoned.
Fined. He can be
imprisoned,
or worst of all,
death.
His life can be taken. Notice the three punishments for crime relate to the three great unalienable rights that we've already talked about: the rights to life, liberty, and property. Death. Okay. If a person is fined today, where does that fine usually go? Not always, but usually. You notice this? To the government. And if he's incarcerated, he goes to prison. And who pays to keep him in prison? The victims. Right? Oh, wait a minute. The fine goes to the government, and the victims have to keep paying to keep him in prison. And I don't know about your state, but in my state, it's between $25,000 and $30,000 per year to keep a person in prison. Well, unless you're in Sheriff Joe's jail. That's my sheriff, right? In his tent city. He'll say, don't come to my jail. You won't like it there. You have to wear pink underwear. There's only two meals a day, and those are very basic meals. You can have no girly magazines, no HBO. It is very basic. And you may have to live in a tent. And in 115 degrees, it's shady, but it's warm. Of course, it's dry. It's warm. You won't like it there, so don't come. That's good. Do you see this, folks?
What's the third punishment? Fine, imprisonment, and what?
Death.
Death.
Yeah. Now, in ancient Israel, if you steal a sheep, the Old Testament says, what's your punishment? You have to do what? You have to give two sheep back. One to replace the one you stole, and the other to make it hurt. We call that punitive damage, so you don't do it anymore. And where do those two sheep go? To the victim. See, that's reparation to the victim. You injure someone, you repay the victim. That's God's law of justice. Amazing. Today, we want to throw everything on society's fault. And so society has to pay. Well, that's another issue, but that needs to be explored. This law of justice in the Old Testament, great. And I don't have time to go through this, but an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, does not mean if you poke somebody's eye out in a fight that you're taken down and your eye's poked out. That doesn't mean that. What good does it do to have two half-blind guys walking around camp? I mean, where's the justice there? See, anyway. Okay. Number 13, the main thrust of government was from the people upward. In other words, people's law is like this, folks. The solutions must come from the people upward. If you have this, this is ruler's law. This is people's law. We need to remember that, right? You can solve your local problems here. You don't have to have somebody from Washington coming down and telling you what to do. However, the founders realized that once in a while, you might have to have some of this. This is during an emergency, mostly during wartime. This is called the War Powers, and that's your blank top, page 20. War Power. When Congress, not the president, declares war. Now get this. The founders did not want the president deciding to go to war. Do we have a problem with that? Yes. They were so tired of King George deciding to go to war, and then the whole empire has to rally their forces and send their money and their men to fight the king's war. They said, uh-uh. The representatives of the people will be the ones to decide when we go to war, because the people will have to send their money and their children to fight the war, so their representatives should make the decision when it's time to do that. Do you get that? This is powerful constitutional doctrine. And when there is a declared war, then that gives the president certain war powers that he wouldn't otherwise have. He may have to, for example, direct an industry to manufacture certain weaponry or ammunition. May have to take over a highway to transport military supplies. May have to create an agency of government to ration food. I mean, if your national survival depends on it, you may have to have this temporarily, because you don't have time to sit around and debate. See that? But when the war is over, all of those things done under the war powers go back.
Supposedly.
Except the war on terror is never over.
Mm-hmm. Do you know that we have agencies of government that exist today, mostly under different names, that were created under the War Powers Act of World War I? I thought World War I was over.
We still have those government boards 90 years later.
Yeah. See, we got a problem with this. We haven't been true to the founders' formula. And then there came another war, another declared war, and we had more agencies. Now you have agencies of government without a declared war. We are far afield from this formula, folks. So, number 14, the government was required to operate according to principles of law, not the whims of czars or men. I'm saying that. Okay? But above all, the transfer of power is still by peaceful means. Relatively peaceful, anyway. Peaceful. So that's basic laws of Israel. Okay? Now, just real briefly here before we have lunch. Do you remember the Israelites? The northern 10 tribes separated themselves from the tribe of Judah. Do you remember that story? Do you remember the question, the basis on which they separated? This is interesting. I'll just mention it without getting into detail. It was on the subject of taxes. That's an interesting story. When the 10 tribes separated themselves under the leadership of Jeroboam and went into this 200 years of abject apostasy. And then it was Elijah and Elisha and other prophets that tried to get them to repent and not worship Baal and so forth. And it didn't work long term. So who conquered the 10 tribes? You remember this in history? What nation came and conquered the 10 tribes?
Assyria.
Assyria. took them up, held them captive for about 100 years until the Babylonians came up and conquered the Assyrians, and the 10 tribes escaped to the north and settled in what is now north of the Black Sea. That's your blank, Black Sea. And in due time, the 10 tribes disappeared from that area. Hence, they're known as the Lost 10 Tribes. Okay? Under letter A now, Roman numeral 3, the Anglo-Saxons trace their beginnings back to a people called Yinglings. See that second line, second word, Yinglings? Not Dinglings, Yinglings. Yinglings. Who actually lived in that same area centuries later where the 10 tribes disappeared. And when the Roman legions, B is Roman, Roman legions were coming around that area in 65 BC, probably under Pompey and so forth, conquering that whole territory, the Yinglings said, we got to get out of here. So they left and they went up the Dnieper River in southern Russia over into northern Europe, conquered or intermingled with the group known as the Sakai and became known as Yingling Sakai. These people became very well known for their fighting ability, their independence, their freedom-loving natures. And if you remember, around 450 AD, Rome was having problems. The Roman Empire was crumbling. So they pulled the Roman soldiers out of Britain, and that left a vacuum. And some of the Celts that were there invited these Yingling Sakai to come into the Isle of Britain and help defend themselves against other Celts. That's your blank for C, C-E-L-T-S, top of page 21. This is where the King Arthur legends all come from. And so these Yinglings came in to Britain and did what they were asked to do and decided to stay in Britain. Even changed the name of Britain to Yingling Land. Okay, we just call it England, of course. And became the best organized people of all of Europe. Letter D, a branch of which became known as the Vikings. The Vikings. Letter E, many have thought that the Yinglings or Anglos included a branch of the ancient Israelites because they came from the territory of the Black Sea and because they preserved by some means the same unique institutes of government that were given to the Israelites at Mount Sinai that we've already discussed. And so here's how the Anglo-Saxons were organized. Number one, they considered themselves a commonwealth of freemen. Do you remember the language of the Magna Carta? These are the inalienable rights of all freemen. Okay? And this is how they were organized. Letter A, the head of 10 families was called a tithing man. Tithing man. This is not the guy going around collecting the tithing. This is the 10th man, which is what tithing means, right? 10th? Okay. Letter B, the head of 50 families has become a little obscure in the research, but may have been a villman or head of the village. Village. The head of 100 families was called a 100 man. The 100 man. Those of you who do, who have family roots in England, I've done some research, and the Taylors come from the Shire of Kent, and I've seen a real early map of Kent, and it's broken down into all these little territories called hundreds. Hundreds. Which hundred did your family come from? And the leader was called the 100 man. Okay. Letter D, the head of 1,000 families was called the elderman. I like this one. Later shortened to Earl. Earl. You've heard of us Earls. Okay. The territory occupied by 1,000 families was called a shire, and the administrative assistant to the earl was called the shire reeve. We pronounce it sheriff. Which I might say, according to the founders, should be the highest level of law enforcement and policing. Yes, the highest level. You think about this, folks. If you're going to hire a police officer, and you're going to delegate him authority to watch people, to arrest people, and give him police powers, You want to keep that very local. So if something goes wrong, all you got to do is go up to the police chief or the county sheriff and say, hey, you need to do something here with this guy. Did you see that? That's a lot of power. You don't want that power on a state or federal level. You come along, you go outside here and you see this police car going by and it's got on a national police force. And the guy goes crazy, does something he shouldn't do. Where do you got to go to solve the problem?
Washington.
What are you going to do there? Nothing. Have you noticed where police enforcement is gravitating to higher and higher levels?
DHS.
Don't want that to happen. These sheriffs should be re-enthroned with what they should really be. And these local police chiefs. You keep that local. When J. Edgar Hoover was head of the FBI during the gangster era of the 30s, politicians wanted him to create a national police force. He flatly refused. He said, you do that, you'll lose your republic. That's right.
Mr. Taylor.
Yes, sir.
Could that be one of the reasons why your sheriff out in Arizona is having so much trouble? Is because the state and or the federal government want to take the powers that have been given to him by the people of where he lives away from him?
Absolutely. I'll just tell you this. Before our present governor, Jan Brewer, do you know who our governor was?
Yes, Janet Napolitano. Yes.
And those two, because they're both in elected position, Arpaio and Napolitano, they were always at crosswise. Well, now that she's in the federal, I don't know if you've noticed, there's more federal investigations and so forth.
Got it.
I don't know.
Can we say thank you again for her?
Well.
Just thought I'd ask.
Okay, whatever. Question. Anyway. Yeah, you want to keep that law enforcement very local. Yes, sir.
How can purely local law enforcement deal with huge level interstate or even national, international crimes? Like drug cartels, or like electronic cyber crime, or interstate bands of criminals like during the Depression, where they would travel from state to state, never staying in one place long enough to get caught.
Okay, we're not saying don't have any investigating bodies on the federal level. That's what the FBI was supposed to do, it's what it stands for, Federal Bureau of Investigation. They were not meant to be law enforcers. They investigated crime and made their investigations available to local police departments. That's the key. The federal government, as we'll learn this afternoon, must maintain border security of our nation. But things that happen within need to be under the jurisdiction of local police and sheriffs with the investigative ability on a national level. That's fine, to have common databases and so forth so they can have immediate information. That would work wonderfully well. But the whole thing's got to be decentralized. Okay? Number three, all laws as well as the election of leaders, this is Anglo-Saxon, had to be by the common consent of the people. Number five, authority granted in chief to a chieftain in time of war was extremely limited. You might be interested to know that the word king in English comes from the Anglo-Saxon word cyning, C-Y-N-I-N-G, which means one among equals. In other words, he's no better, he has no more rights, human rights that is, he's one among equals. If there's an emergency, we have a leader, and the emergency's over, he's back with the people. In other words, and I love to use this phrase, all the laws apply to all the people. There are no special laws for special classes of people. All the laws apply to all the people. That's principle of freedom. And over on the next page, their system of justice was based on payment of damages to the victim. You injure somebody, you repay the victim. And now, I won't take time to get into a lot of details on this. Trilby, how are we doing over there?
I'm still going to give you a few minutes. Are you close to a stopping point?
No, I can go on.
Why don't you go on for 10 more minutes?
Okay, all right, then we'll get into a little more details. Okay, thank you. Have you noticed, folks, natural law at play here? A lot of these things we've mentioned, I hope you're logging it in as natural law. Reparation to the victim, why would that be natural law? You injure somebody, you repay them. See, that's natural law, right?
Biblical principle.
Pardon me?
A biblical principle.
Biblical principle, right. These are all natural laws, yes.
If all the laws applied to all people, then why does Congress have the power to exclude themselves from the law?
Amen.
Now look at that.
They're elitist.
If all the laws apply to all the people, why does Congress have the right to exclude themselves from certain laws?
They don't have the right.
And this is what we get from these great young people who start learning these principles.
Mm-hmm.
How come it sounds so simple? Why are we doing it?
Yeah, thank you, young lady. It's great. So the founders said, okay, we have natural law principles in government. What about in day-to-day relationships among people? Business relationships, economics. Are there natural law principles that apply?
There should be.
And do you know, there was a book published right in the nick of time to answer that question for the founders. 1776. Adam Smith published his big book, the short title of which is The Wealth of Nations. And did you get your blank there next to the picture as natural? And in that book, Adam Smith explains for the first time, some marvelous principles of economics based on natural law. First of all, he says, you know, kings and rulers have always said if they've got a pile of gold sitting in their treasury that we're wealthy, the nation is wealthy. And he comes along and he says, just because you have a pile of gold in your treasury, that doesn't mean you're wealthy. Wealth is not gold and silver. Those are your blanks for letter B. You can't eat it. You can't wear it. Doesn't keep you warm. It's not gold and silver. He says, true wealth is when people have things that make life comfortable. Comfortable housing, comfortable clothing, comfortable transportation. And when people have those things, you can then say the nation is wealthy. See that? And then he says, how do you make those things available? How do you create a wealthy nation? You make these things that make life comfortable for people abundant and cheap. Letter C, abundant and cheap. And then he, for the first time, explains how to do that. Now, to you and me, this is going to sound rather simplistic, because we've lived under it, and it's just kind of common. But in those days, it wasn't. So here's the formula. Number one, you specialize production. In other words, if you make shoes, you just make shoes. You get real good at making good shoes. Make a lot of them. Build a factory. Hire people. You just make shoes. That's your specialty. And if you need a new wagon, don't stop making shoes to build yourself a new wagon. You go down to the local blacksmith and say, Mr. Smith, I see you need a new pair of shoes. Maybe your whole family needs a new pair of shoes. Tell you what I'll do. I'll trade a few pair of shoes for one of your nice new wagons. What's that? Yeah, it's buying and selling in a free market. That's your blank for two. Free market. Where it's total freedom, how many shoes equal a wagon between the buyer and the seller. Nobody's gonna tell you how much, okay? No regulation on it, okay? Free market. Number three, based on the natural law of supply and demand. Did you get that? Natural law of supply and demand. Where people vote with their dollars on what they want or don't want. Have you ever thought about when you're buying something, you're actually voting? You're voting for what you buy, and you're voting against what you leave on the shelf. Does someone get the message?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Silently and powerfully. You don't need a bunch of committees saying what you can do and what you can manufacture and how much it's going to cost and all this. Totally free market. This is beautiful. Natural law concepts. Okay? Where everyone, number four, improves his position by making a profit. Profit, P-R-O-F-I-T, which is defined as doing whatever is worthwhile, doing whatever is necessary to make an exchange worthwhile. Worthwhile. And if an exchange isn't worthwhile, because there's no profit, then there will be no exchange. And everything will slow down, right? Now I've got to ask this question. How many of you here are in business for yourselves? Okay, good number. Now, I'm going to ask you a question. I know you'll be honest with me, you business owners. Do you love competition?
No.
Yeah, that's honest. Or do you wish you were the only fish in the pond with your service or product? That's a little tempting, isn't it? To wish I was the only one, right? But Adam Smith comes along and he says, as painful as it is, you've got to keep competition in the mix because it provides good things, okay? And how do you keep competition in the mix?
Nominal.
Yes. You don't let government set rules about what you have to do and comply with to get into an industry. Does that sound familiar? In other words, you don't limit. Somebody wants to get into an industry, let them do it. That invites competition as much as people want to give. Yes, ma'am.
Talking about supply and demand, the local gas station has urged everybody not to buy gas on the 15th.
Well, okay, they're free to do that, and everybody's free to do that. That'd be wonderful to see what would happen. Yeah, a little protest there, right? Okay. So what does competition produce? This is Adam Smith. He explained all this. Under number five, he says it produces greater quantity. Quantity. Yeah, you got to make more in order to produce more in order to make more. It improves quality. Quality to attract those customers. It lowers prices. Lowers prices. And it creates a greater variety. Wouldn't it be boring to shop someplace where you just only have one choice? I mean, you only choose one, but it's kind of nice to have it. Okay.
Only big shoes.
Adam Smith says the greatest threat to a free market economy is government interference. Interference. And how does government interfere? Well, you see a whole list of them there. Fixing prices, fixing wages, controlling production, controlling distribution, subsidizing production. Now we could add bailouts and whatever else. That's how government interferes with the free market. But Adam Smith said there are four things that where government should get involved if necessary. And here they are. Letter A, to prevent illegal force. You know, this is where you walk into a store and lean over the counter and say, listen, buddy, you better buy my brand of booze or I'm driving my truck right through your front window. That's illegal force. Okay? Letter B is fraud. Government should prevent fraud. I have here some beautiful beachfront property in Arizona. Are you interested? That would be fraud, wouldn't it? Somebody says, yet. Letter C, government should prevent monopoly. Now, this is an interesting subject because usually temporary monopolies are taken care of in the free market, aren't they? I mean, if you create a product, you invent a product, and you have it, what do you have automatically? A monopoly. Okay? Until? Somebody makes it a little better, a little cheaper, whatever. See, the market will take care of it. What we're talking about here is permanent monopolies, which are usually created by government. You want to solve the health care mess in this country? I'll tell you how to do it. Take the monopoly off of it. Just take the monopoly off of it. You'll see health care costs go down and service go up. Same way with the legal profession. Take the monopoly off of it.
In public schools.
Freedom is amazing. Yes.
Monopolies can also be created by private contract. So I think the right to contract for what services people will use, especially in the long term, has to be limited. Otherwise, every computer would come with a contract saying you'll only run Microsoft software on it, and that's it. And we would all agree to it because there would be no other choice for 99.9% of us.
That's how they used to come.
Maybe for a while, that's true. Yeah. But eventually, as we've seen in other things, the free market will topple a monopolistic enterprise that thinks they own everything. You got to keep it free. You just have to have a lot of faith in freedom. Our tendency as humans is to, when we see something that doesn't look quite right, to do something about it, to regulate it, or use some force. But we just have to have faith in freedom. I believe, even in some of these situations, people bring up Walmart also. You just let the free market handle it, and in time, the free market will. That's my faith.
Or regulated at the localist level.
Pardon me?
Or regulated at the most local level. So it doesn't contagion and go everywhere else.
Okay, but that must be kept very local, mm-hmm. So it can be changed if necessary. And letter D, the fourth thing that Adam Smith says where government should be involved is in the area of debauchery. D-E-B-A-U-C-H-E-R-Y. What in the world is that? These are things that play on the weaknesses of people. And there's a list of them there. And pornography, obscenity, drugs, prostitution. You could probably add gambling and whatever else. And other forms of vice. Now, this is where some of our good libertarian friends kind of disagree in some areas with us, with the founders, and with Adam Smith. Because some people say, well, these are victimless crimes, and if the person wants to choose to be involved in them, then government shouldn't say they can't. And all Adam Smith said and the founders said, and this goes back to Blackstone, by the way, he explains this pretty clearly. Evil always spreads. And if you could keep evil, if you could keep these things totally isolated and totally private, okay, human law shouldn't touch them. But if you notice, every one of these things always seeks to influence other people. They do not stay private. I tell my students, it's the nature of evil to affect other people, if you notice that. And then they do become as Blackstone says, of pernicious effect to society. And it is the business of human laws to correct them. But where should those human laws be? Very local. This is why in the First Amendment, Congress was prohibited from getting involved in areas of religion, speech, press, and so forth. Because you don't want laws controlling these kinds of things on the federal level necessarily. You have them very local. And you may have a different standard here in Forsyth County than they do in Las Vegas, Nevada. I'll guarantee you do.
And if people don't like it, they can leave.
That's correct. You keep laws very local. But when we say government, sometimes we get confused about what government is and say, well, government shouldn't be involved in certain decisions. Well, the federal government shouldn't, that's true. But people get together in communities to protect themselves, to protect the environment in which to raise their children. That's government too. And the founders and Adam Smith would say they have every right to set standards for their community. We will not have this stuff in our community. See that? I'll show you this afternoon how the 14th Amendment was the basis on which all of that is changing. Where local people don't have that authority anymore. I'll show you that this afternoon. Well, anyway, that's Adam Smith. His big, thick book can be boiled down into four basic freedoms. The freedom to try. This is, as I said, the freedom to try without any regulation on what you have to do to get into an industry. Freedom to try, the freedom to buy, the freedom to sell, and the freedom to fail. That's an interesting one. I was.
When you're done.
Okay, I just got to tell you this quick little story. So I was talking to a group of sixth graders years ago in one of the elementary schools there in Mesa. And we happened to mention some of this, and I said, how many of you want the freedom to fail? Well, that sounds kind of ominous to a sixth grader, right? Nobody wanted the freedom to fail. So I said, okay, what do your dads do for a living? And it turned out about half of them were in construction. That's back when we used to be building houses in Arizona. Okay, and I said, okay, what time does your dad get up to work? Get up in the morning to go to work. And one little boy says, about 2:30. I said, why does he do that? So he can get a good day's work in before it gets hot. Okay, good. What would happen if he didn't do that? And this little boy says, we wouldn't have nice things. I said, you mean he would fail? Yeah. I said, well, aren't you glad he has the freedom to fail so he won't? This little boy thought for a minute. He says, yeah. I said, how many of you want the freedom to fail? Everybody's hand went up. That's great. We need to talk about this with young people. Freedom, you've got to have the freedom to fail, because if you don't, you won't have the freedom to succeed. And that's Adam Smith. Well, you've been a great group here this morning. Do you have any instructions?
We have instructions. All right.
Can we have a blessing before we eat?
Would you please say a blessing before we eat? I'm sorry.
Father, again, we thank you for the time that we can share and learn so much about our own country and our own history. We thank you, Lord, for that opportunity. And now may this food that has been prepared for us, may it nourish our bodies and strengthen us so that we can come forth this afternoon and be so thrilled for being here. Amen and amen.
Amen.